My name is Sam Bisbee. I'm the CTO at ThreatStack, where we do continuous security monitoring for workloads typically deployed in clouds and hybrid clouds, a lot of AWS. And we collect metrics and telemetry from our customer servers in real time. We've got this cool little agent that sits on our customer servers, and it sends us more or less every single syscall that happens in their Linux operating system, basically in real time, plus a bunch of other data, and then we collect other feeds from CloudTrail and whatnot. And we GA'd about 2 years ago at reInvent, and it has been an interesting scaling story since there. You know, in our first month, or first couple months after GA'ing, there was about four of us working full-time on scaling and building the platform, and we hit our first terabyte of data in a single day. We weren't ready for that. That was an interesting experience. And we had had prior experience on Dynamo and NoSQL systems. Personally, I was previously at a company called Cloudant, which did distributed database as a service based on Apache CouchDB using Dynamo Quorum. So we're like, yeah, we got this. And then we got a terabyte in a day. And we're like, we have to do this again tomorrow? Crap. So we were running Cassandra. And what we found was that a lot of the problems that we were feeling were inherently time series and also inherently not time series, right? In those early days, we basically just burned money to get things to work. Just the amount of animated GIFs in then HipChat, later Slack, of just like the woman throwing money into a fireplace, that was just like a daily occurrence. Like, crap, more data, all right, more I2s, let's do it. That doesn't work for very long. I will say though, we successfully ran that cluster at 90% disk utilization for a good 6+ months, so kudos to us. A lot of the guidance that we got out there was completely horrible because it wasn't focused on our use case. Everybody was talking about, I don't know, shopping carts, you know, if people were talking about time series data, they were talking about like collecting metrics on CPUs, which is integers and really easy compared to us where we've got these big JSON blobs for every single syscall coming up to us in real time. So that wasn't too cool. Luckily for us, we were in the DataStax startup program. And so we got this guy named Sebastian to help us out as a startup. He is now an SE working on bigger companies, which is too bad, but he helped us out in the very early days. We've also got this very unique thing that Cassandra really doesn't agree with, which is our data loses value over time, right? Cassandra assumes that your data has a constant state of high value forever. Like, if you give it data, it wants to have it forever and it doesn't ever want to delete it. For us, we sell customers a retention period. So, you know, you pay per agent per month and then some variable on top of that for the number of days that we store data for you, and then you can search over that data. That means we have to keep it hot in our environment, available to you to do ad hoc search on. Well, that's hard, so we're gonna charge you extra money for that because hard drives are expensive. But that also means that every single second that we hold on to a piece of data outside of that retention window is waste, just straight waste. Like it's the same as, you know, donut holes, except we can't resell them. We also have this interesting problem that not all sensors are equal. In our first couple of months, we had, you know, hundreds, thousands, whatever the number was, of agents reporting to us. And on one day, we actually had two single agents from a single customer represent 98% of our platform's load on that day. Let me tell you, that schema did not work. Right, but fundamentally, I think that time series data breaks down into, I guess this is a magic quadrant, but not. You know, in the bottom left-hand corner is pretty much where, you know, Web 2.0, you know, you have low volume of transactions, low data size. I really wish I could go back and build those systems. You know, the kind of canonical Cassandra examples, that top left, system monitoring, traditional object store, CDNs, whatever kind of I put in that bottom right hand. And then because we're ThreatStack, we need to be up and to the right on everything, right? Well, that sucks, right? Because this is a really asinine problem to solve, right? When you have a high transaction volume, and the actual transactions are large, you're like scaling in way too many different ways at the same time, and there was four of us, so that wasn't too much fun. But there's another very important constraint that we have, margins, right? That's a thing. There's a lot of people out there who just kind of keep that whole burning money strategy going forever and ever and ever, and we weren't allowed to do that, right? We're from Boston, we're thrifty New Englanders, we're crufty, we don't like spending cash on anything, right? So the data as of today, right? So we're collecting 5, 10, 10s, whatever, I don't even really know on a given day. We're collecting a lot of terabytes every day. High transaction rate, like I said. One of the other interesting things, like a lot of the answers that people tried to give us was, hey, batch, ETL, Spark. No, because we're a streaming real-time platform. Like we have customers when they have a, like they'll fail a login attempt or their malware runs, whatever, exploit, bad guys, Russians, whatever, right? When that happens on their system, then they alt tab and they expect and they do see a ThreatStack alert sitting in their Slack channel. And then their CEO pings them and say, what the hell is that? And they say, I mistyped my password, right? But the point is, from kind of an event hitting our edge of our platform to it being on every disk, sliced, aggregated, through the alert pipeline and pushed out to notification services, we have an internal, we don't promise this to customers, we have an internal SLA of 1 second. We warn at that, we start to wake people up when it gets longer. But so that kind of takes out the whole, you know, batch thing. Not that batch programming is fun anyway. We're also unique in that we're pretty much all right. You know, users are on the platform, but I don't care how many queries you run on my app, you're not going to come even close to touching the amount of data we're collecting. We try and pre-compute as much as possible, right? All right, we're collecting all this data. We've got to show pretty dashboards, whatever, make people happy, usability, et cetera, et cetera. So we pre-compute as much as possible. We're completely on AWS, spread across 3 availability zones in US East, just like the other half of the internet. We distrust remote storage. That's partially because of building systems in the past. That's partially through scaling, well, slash surviving the great EBS outage in US East. But I don't want to completely bash, this is not a complete EBS bashing thing, right? It's just remote storage puts another hop, and now that's another multi-tenant circuit that is now introducing latency into our write path. We don't want to have to design around that for reliability. Oh, and by the way, I don't, like, the EBS team has done phenomenal things in making EBS better, but you're still not going to get the reliable I/O throughput on EBS that you're going to get from local disk. So it is. And by the way, we're on Cassandra 2.1. So new fanciness doesn't work for us, and we are very much believers in not releasing anything that the Cassandra community releases for a good 6 months. So we won't be on 3.0 for a while. Generic data model. I like to say this to people we are hiring and then they almost want to quit, but we assume that everything is partially ordered, eventually consistent, write-ahead log. And that's when they leave the room. And this is great, right? It's insert only, you're never doing updates, we're not using counters, like, so we get rid of basically all the things that people typically trip over with Cassandra. We don't do deletes, right? So we don't have tombstone other than like tombstones in the systems key space. We don't really have tombstones. But we have to therefore acknowledge that duplicate writes will happen. And that's just something that we take, right? There's legitimate things like, you know, failed batches, RabbitMQ wonkiness, whatever. And then there's the how do you even computer problem of time travelers on our platform because people can't configure goddamn NTP and they send me data from 1970. I also, we can actually see, we have to pre-create like let's say Elasticsearch indices or other systems, we have to pre-create things roughly 3 hours before UTC midnight because we start to see data from the future, right? It's just asinine. But we're a security company, we take it, partially because we have to deal with the fact that a bad actor might actually adjust the clock on the system as a way to actually tamper with logs and other telemetry systems like us, so we have to account for that. It just sucks. But ultimately, we're TTLing on insert time, and then we store and query on event time. There's a lot of kind of like, hey, time series aggregation built on Cassandra out there, guides and actual systems that assume, like I said, everything is integers, and they're kind of rolling everything up into these buckets. Like, they'll take one record, and then they'll kind of aggregate it and write it into the 1 minute, 5 minute granularity, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That doesn't really work well for us. Like, we're just masochistic, right? We allow people to run raw searches and get to a granular syscall from a specific server with every single field from the Linux kernel on it, right? And then we also do these like really big rollups and everything else. But it means that there's really no concept of like, I want a 15-minute granularity, right? Because we're not doing charts and graphs. I mean, we are because we have to do demos, but ultimately, this system is not trying to serve charts and graphs. So when it came to schemas, we knew that we were going to screw up a lot, and we did. And we knew that we were trying to do insert only, and so we completely embraced that. We kind of took the treat your servers like cattle, not pets, approach that AWS and everybody else is saying, and we apply that to our tables, right? So we never wanted to do alter table because that's not a lot of fun when you have a lot of data in it. So instead, we just create a new schema, create a new table, you know, process tree, foobar, weirdness, cool stuff, version 2, right, whatever. We deploy code in our data access layer that reads from both and zips the results together into the result that our API servers are expecting. We deploy that out, and we make sure reads are still surfacing on the app, everything is good, okay? And then we release a modification to the event ingestion pipeline, and it basically just cuts writes over to the new table. And we can stagger that out kind of one consumer at a time, one writer at a time, and we can see just basically it's slowly cut over and everything is good. Awesome. This is huge because we can actually test every single one of these steps, right? We can write unit tests, we can write integration tests, everything else, and that gives us a high level of trust that when we actually release something into the pipeline that we're not going to completely screw it up, mostly. There is some inherent cost in doing this, right? We are like carbon copying a lot of fields and a lot of pieces of data. But in our estimation, given how easy it is for us to build and develop and iterate, and the better read performance that our ultimate UI gets, it's worth carrying that extra, the extra bits. And then, you know, people can just kind of YOLO out new schemas and new analysis, no problem. Like I said, but so no EBS bashing, right? But my number one problem with EBS as a CTO is that I can't RI it. Amazon will give you a lot of reasons for why you can't RI it. I believe some of them, I fundamentally also think that it comes down to that there's probably three people at AWS who really know how that service works because it's been around for so long, just like any other tech company with a legacy system. So we originally rolled out on i2.2 XLs, like I said, just burning money like nobody's business. It was awesome because every time we screwed up, every time we learned about a new configurable in Cassandra, whatever, we would tune it, restream, redo whatever we needed, and we had SSDs, and holy crap, did we leverage that. But then, again, we had to stop doing that, and so we moved on to 2XLs, and so, excuse me, D2 2XLs in 2015. So basically, that gives you 6 spindles, then we RAID 0 them, and now we've got way more disk capacity than DataStax recommends that you should have on a single node, but whatever, we don't care. We break the seal on a lot of settings, and it works for us, so why not? And so this is what it ends up looking like. And these are just numbers based on the AWS price sheet when I was on the JetBlue flight yesterday. And really all that this slide is trying to get across is that RIing EBS would be a really great thing, so if you work at AWS, please do this. But, you know, you're going to be paying basically 10x more to use your C3 whatever with enough EBS to hit the equivalent disk capacity. And congratulations, now you've got remote storage, which is going to have, you know, worse performance. So now you're paying 10x more for a worse availability story and more fault domains. And, you know, if Dynamo goes down, then, you know, tagging goes out on AWS and you can't even find your disks anymore because that's the metadata service that relies on, right? So get rid of it. All of this is just raw disk, of course, right? We're not counting for N equals 3 and all that other magic. It's also slightly not fair because the I2s are giving you a lot more and reduced disk space as a result. So it's not completely fair, but whatever, I don't care. It makes the point that I want to make. All this being said, all of that data that we're collecting every day, we're not actually storing all of it in Cassandra all of the time. We used to. What we found was because we wanted to delete that data, it was actually a really bad solution, even with DTCS, which we're going to be crapping all over in a second. The restreaming was really one of the biggest killers, right? Every time we needed to replace a node, every time AWS shot something in the head, my bandwidth bill would just like skyrocket, and I didn't really feel like doing that anymore. We didn't really feel like doing that anymore. The disk utilization with EBS, right? When you're doing that restreaming, the disk on EBS was always, always, always the bottleneck. You could not read off of that fast enough, especially if, because you're, it's bad enough that you're going through a multi-tenant circuit on the thing that's trying to write the data down, but all those other nodes in the cluster in those remote racks that are trying to send data, they're also taking writes from the pipeline because we can't turn the pipeline off, right? It always has to be on. So now that multi-tenant circuit that's trying to read data up as fast as it can because we unbounded the stream throughput on the cluster so we could get this done in a day instead of 7 days. Now it's trying to like also write data at the same time, and now queues are backing up. It was all just kind of horrible. The other reason was like we care about data, but if you remember, data loses value for us. So like, yes, it would be absolutely horrible if we lost data, and we really work hard not to do that. However, if I lose a single data point, or if I lose 1% of my data or whatever, and that data is older than 24 to 48 hours, there's a pretty close to 0% chance you're ever gonna run a query and figure that out. And that's a really horrible thing to say standing up here, but at the same time, when you're designing systems like this, those are the kinds of trade-offs that you need to make, right? You could just make the sales argument of like, oh yeah, it's just a built-in feature. It's statistical sampling, it's fine, right? I've actually said that to a customer once and they agreed with me, which was pretty cool. Right, so therefore, we've got this raw data sitting in another storage system, we've got all of our analysis and some of the raw data in Cassandra, so we need to tile all of this together, right? So for us, every single row, or every single query must constrain the sensor ID and the event day, right? So we're bucketing all the data into those days for a given sensor because the sensor ID is important because all of this is multi-tenant, right? I'm putting my massive Fortune 100 customer on the same hard drives that I'm putting, you know, two people in a loft with three servers, right? And then when the data comes out, it must also include those two pieces of data plus the event ID. That triple or the batch of triples we then take and we go to our raw data solution system and we say, hey, give me this batch based on these triples, sends it back, and then you send that up to whatever system was making the original request. And all this still works within a second. Like, even though you're going and doing a hop to a distributed system that's doing multiple hops, pulling stuff off disk, maybe Bloom if you're lucky, and then going to another remote system across another hop that's doing its own then multiple hops to go fetch stuff, like, yes, that's a lot of hops. Still happens in less than a second. Typically, the whole thing takes maybe tens to hundreds of milliseconds. I'm completely okay with that. I think people typically get overly worried and concerned about it, hops, which they shouldn't be, right? And so, as you might expect, the partition key includes part of that triple. What's really interesting is with RabbitMQ, so we don't cluster RabbitMQ, we basically use it as a big, long, continuous series of pods, right? So a single RabbitMQ server has n different consumers on it for all the different queues and all the different types of analysis that we want to do. A single consumer is only allowed to talk to a single database or store or whatever else. We ban two-phase commits completely in our platform, except for one exception. And so that way we're mapping a single AMQP transaction off of RabbitMQ, the semantics of that, to a single Cassandra batch transaction, right? And so yes, like I said earlier, we're gonna get multiple redeliveries, we could do multiple writes, but it's okay because the key is deterministic, and therefore we're basically just gonna be overwriting the same data again and again and again. That's not too bad. And then, so we do the, you know, batching best practices, which is not unique to time series, of batching on the partition key, right? So that we can kind of, you don't have, a coordinator doesn't need to go across multiple locations in the ring. And then we also batch on 512.0 bytes because Cassandra logs when you send it a payload larger than that, and I like pretty logs, and so I want to get rid of that warning. That's literally the only reason I did it. So compaction, data, deletions. This is really the hard part of this entire conversation, right? We started on STCS. That was horrible, right? We couldn't delete data. We were talking to Sebastian, other people, DataStax, whoever. You could rotate tables. I could also do that on MySQL. Try again. You could rotate clusters. React and Basho suggested that to me, and that sounded like a horrible operational life. This was not DataStax, this was somebody else in the community, literally told me we could generate every historic permutation of keys within that time bucket with Spark and then run deletes on those permutations. I just like closed my laptop and left. I'm like, fuck that, that's completely crazy. Like, even when I said these are the numbers of things that we're collecting and all, and I did the math like a jackass, I'm like, this is like how many different permutations you asked me to run deletes for. He's like, yeah, do that. No. So then DTCS came out, right? And we're like, yes, finally, time series will work on Cassandra the way it was always meant to work. No. So data still kept getting stuck, right? So if you use SS table metadata, you can go and see the kind of youngest and oldest writes in a given SST. So you do that and you're, you know, let's say you're on a 30-day retention. You're like, why am I holding data from 6 months ago? This is crazy. Meanwhile, my disk keeps going up. This is because DTCS decides what SSTs it can unlink off of disk and should filter for compaction based on the most recent write to that SST. Here's the thing. If you're constantly writing data into an SST, that timestamp is gonna keep moving and therefore it's never gonna move past the boundary and stop compaction on that SS table. That means that SS table will be eligible for compaction with other SS tables with other older data for infinity. Literally what we were saying, right? And so then we were basically just using STCS with TTLs. That's not that awesome. So ultimately, right, this is a graph of what you want versus what you get. Right? What you want is, I've got this new table, I'm gonna write data into it, and then I'm gonna hit my TTL period, and it's not literally gonna be a flat line, but I should start to get a sawtooth. Like, it should start to look like JVM heap, right? Garbage collection, right? I fill up for that day, and I drop the old day. I fill up for a day, I drop the old day, right? Nope, you get that top to the right, right? Just keep eating that disk, keep throwing hard drives at it. That sucks. So, we whiteboarded this for a very long time. We're like, there has to be an answer. Kept coming back to that goddamn timestamp. So I like to tell people that we wrote our own compaction strategy because that makes us look really cool. Because this is a database conference, so it, at least I think it's cool. This is actually what we did. This is open source. We just flipped the logic. We told it to use the oldest write instead of the newest write. I literally went in, I extended the class, called it min timestamp compaction strategy. The rest of that function, documentation, everything, that's just a copy and paste. And then I went to that single line and I rewrote max to min. So I changed two characters. I submitted this to ASF and the Cassandra project. And they replied back, oh, we think DTCS is too broken. We're going another direction. No thanks. Close the ticket. All right, fine. That's their choice. It's open source. It's free, right? So we've been running this in production. If you go to that GitHub page, it's like, you know, warning, experimental, we do not support. We've been running this thing in production for a stupid long time. And considering the diff on it, it's experimental, meaning it's pretty goddamn safe. We then also modify some settings. So we never run repairs. I'm just gonna say, if you're truly doing insert only, and you're truly ETLing data out of your cluster, I'm gonna argue you never need to run a repair on those tables. You can throw fruit at me later. We also disable hinted handoff. We did that even when we were on STCS. I fundamentally always dislike the idea of hinted handoff in any distributed system because if a node goes down because it's taking too much load, and so it hard downs, And now everything is like, oh, that node's down. I'm now going to take a portion of that load for it. I just took that problem and I just spread it to the rest of my cluster. And now the next node is going to go down. Now the cluster sees, oh, two nodes are down. Let me shift the load over to this guy. And you basically just walk the ring, shooting nodes in the head with all that load, right? So that's why I don't like hinted handoffs. Also because of their inherent TTO, and I'd rather not lose that much data. Other thing we do, max SS table age days one. So what this literally means is that 24 hours after a write comes through, we stop compacting that SST. So the amount of compaction happening is actually pretty small. Base time seconds, 1 hour, that's actually a default. Feel free to play with that. But what this means is we basically have 1 hour's worth of data in a single SS table, and it pretty much stops compacting at that point. So in theory, you've got 24 SS tables per table, per day, per node. Everything else is pretty much default. You really don't need to worry about, you know, there's, I won't get into the details. Jeff Dierse does a good talk on this stuff, which I think he might be doing again today. But basically, like when you restream a node, all data gets sent and shit gets really weird, even stuff that should be TTL'd off. And now because it's fundamentally because you're taking out of order writes into the cluster, which DTCS says thou shall not do, which is kind of hilarious. Since it's an eventually consistent system. But you don't really need to worry about that, right? Because the next time you go through and you do a compaction, that really tiny SST with that old data that shouldn't be there is just gonna get unlinked and be gone, right? Well, we were still seeing some old data in the cluster, and that was kind of weird, right? But whatever. So we whipped up some dark, awful magic. So we run this in production today. We have a cron job that fires once an hour. That cron job invokes a script called sstablejanitor.sh. That script basically does an ls of all of the data directories for every table, and Chef tells it what TTLs those things should have. It then loops over every single data SST in there and says sstable metadata, pulls out the min timestamp, compares that to the TTL using, you know, date as one does. And then if it's past the TTL, and this is where shit gets really cool, people, it fires up JMX term and pokes the Cassandra node over JMX saying, hey, please run a force user defined compaction on this file. And because the entire thing is past the TTL, it just unlinks it off of disk. Success, mission accomplished. Yes, it's a hack. Yes, that's crazy, but holy crap, does it work, and I don't care. Here's another bonus. You don't need to save half of your disk space anymore for these tables, right? Because yeah, there's a little bit of compaction happening those first few hours in that first 24 hours, but then it stops. So you don't need to reserve all that disk space. So if you go back to that earlier slide about, you know, 12 terabytes, DataStax recommends you don't do that. But they're saying they don't even recommend that you use 6 of those 12 terabytes. I'm saying you can use 10 to 11 of those terabytes and be completely fine. It's awesome. But ultimately, you start to get the graph that you want, right? And so these are live from a 30-day snapshot of our cluster. I'm sorry, that green is actually kind of awful. I apologize. That top one is the SSTs, the total number of SS tables across all the nodes and across all the tables in the cluster. And the bottom one is disk utilization. And so, again, it's not the exact sawtooth that you want, but that's because sales and marketing does their job and brings in more customers. And so you are going to have a natural increase on that line. But if we didn't, like if sales broke down, we stopped getting new customers, it would just keep just kind of sawtoothing perfectly happy. And you start to get the graphs that you want instead of the graphs that we so horribly drew earlier. Thank you. Questions? Yes, sir. She's running.
Here.
Well, this is an awesome talk.
Thank you.
I work at Uber, and we have some of the very same problems, so I feel your pain with DTCS. I have a question about EBS, though, and
yes.
Some of the research that Instacluster has done in,
yep.
in recommending, actually, EBS,
yep.
and maybe what your thoughts are on that.
Yeah. So, like I said, there's been a lot of really phenomenal work. You know, I've seen talks here, reInvent, other places where people are doing really impressive things with EBS and throughput. maybe this is just inner neckbeard for me, but I don't care. That's fundamentally still a network cable that you're hitting, and really like all the virtual crap on top of it. And Amazon does a lot of things phenomenally well. Networking is not one of them. And I have a very hard time at the end of the day trusting that I'm gonna get the solid IOPS that I want out of it. And then you look at the graphs and you then see the weird spikes and everything else. And I'm already putting more data into these nodes than I should be putting into them. And if I, here's the thing, right? I'm saying, just go full YOLO mode with 11 terabytes on a single Cassandra node, and then stream one, right? So, they get shot in the head, we're doing this, and yeah, okay, it takes many days for that thing to stream, and we're like, hey, we have N equals 3, we'll be fine. I don't think that we could stream and do all the other cluster operations that we need to do at the same time and do that on EBS. Especially based on my experience. So obviously, I'm saying, polyglot all the things. So we've got other systems running. So our stupidly large Elasticsearch cluster that we desperately want to just pummel into the ground. That thing's on EBS, and we are actively working very hard to move that to D2s. If we can't keep up with indexing, which I'm actually concerned about with all those spindles, we might actually have to just burn a stupid amount of money and use I2s while we slowly get rid of Lucene. But just based on every data point I've ever seen, you just still can't do it and still take that data hose in at the same time. But I appreciate the storage engineers who are working on it.
That's a good answer. Yeah.
What is the read and write consistency level that you're using?
Good question. So we use N equals 3, and then we do local core for everything, for reads and writes. In the future, we might have multiple data centers, and then that's a more complex answer, but right now we've only got the one.
You mentioned that you have an alert under 1 second. How do you do it?
RAM and CPU. That doesn't touch disk at all. So we basically got a straight-through processing pipeline with our own custom-built rules engine. Where customers can write behavioral rules, and then we can also inject our own behavioral rules based on the behavior that we've seen in the data, and we can basically slipstream that into our custom engine. And it's just doing straight through processing of that data, and we have multiple tiers of potted RabbitMQ for all the different stages, and CPUs.
Okay, so you don't have any aggregations?
So we do aggregations, but those don't drive alerts. Okay. So there's another completely different part of the pipeline that does the big counts. That's the only thing that doesn't meet the 1 to 2 second SLA. That meets a 10 minute SLA. We tried Spark streaming a little over a year ago, and we found that it's probably gonna be really awesome in 5 years, right? Because there was just stuff where intermediary files just wouldn't get removed off disk, and it was what the hell is going on? So we actually went in and we faked the bucketed RDD concept, and we're just having Spark do 10-minute batches. So every 10 minutes, tasks come up, they go pull data, aggregate, drop those aggregates down into a database, and then shut off. We've basically banned Zookeeper at our company. And Hadoop. So that kind of left us with smaller options on how to use Spark. So we're doing Spark in standalone mode. And because we hate HDFS and Zookeeper and that entire thing, we're doing 10-minute batches out of Redis. We're coming up with a better solution, but it works for now.
You talked a bit about trying to get the value of data as it comes in sort of decreases over time, but it didn't seem like any of the compaction work you did tried to address that directly. It was more that it's valuable, and then it just sort of falls off as opposed to degrading in any way. That sort of didn't get talked about later in the talk.
Yeah, I probably missed one of my notes there and the version of this that I can see. I don't think any database does that. I've talked with every vendor, I've prototyped on fucking everything, and none of them do it, right? Because everybody's like, hey, databases, I put a thing in, it better be there, and then I can pull it out. We're actually working on a homegrown solution on top of RocksDB that we think we're gonna be able to get close to, where we can actually start to build the concept of degraded value into data over time into the core of the engine.
Thank you.
The asinine thing about my answer to you is my answer of we have to go build it. But just one general statement I'll make is like, when you're doing stuff at this volume, at this size, et cetera, you should expect to have to build stuff, and you should expect to understand the internals of any database at a ridiculous level. That also gets really painful because I'm also advocating that you deploy a polyglot architecture, and therefore your entire team needs to understand multiple databases at a ridiculously deep dev level. It's life. This guy, wait, or that one again. Just go for it.
I didn't want to hog all the time. Max SS table age days. Which version of Cassandra are you using? 2.1?
2.1. Specifically, 2.1. We're on DataStax 4.8.4-1. That bundles in Cassandra 2.1.
Okay, cool. Because I think max SS table age days is deprecated in 2.1.12. So cool. Have you experimented with time window compaction strategy much?
So not actively. I've looked at it. I've thought very hard about it, and I've talked with Jeff about it various times. I mean, it seems to be what we originally wanted DTCS to be, just without the PhD logic. I didn't realize that was gonna be kind of a double-edged statement, I apologize. So we are not running that, mostly because that's another third-party person's code that, like, I'm sure it works very well for them. They don't even run it on everything. At least last year they didn't when I last talked to them about that. And for me, you know, the risk associated with a completely brand new strategy that somebody wrote versus I changed two characters in a file that I extended a class on. So I felt a lot better, especially where I could still go back to the community and say, help, and I could still talk to them about DTCS and just kind of hide the fact that I was running MTCS. He's giving me the end.
Yeah, all right,
one more. He's telling me one more.
Okay.
He's friendlier.
You might have actually mentioned this and I missed it, but when you're doing inserts, you have different TTLs depending on the service level for different customers, right? Mm-hmm. Do you insert those into the same table, or you have to separate them at that point? Okay.
Yeah, and that sucks, but. So we used to do multi-tenancy back in the bad old days by having a different table per customer. Let me tell you, people, that's a great way to just like bury your cluster in the ground. I find that Cassandra, even on i2 2XLs, maxes out around 100 tables. That's kind of unfortunate. Cool. So I have ThreatStack socks that I would love to give out to you. Feel free to also accost me in the hallway about anything, throw fruit at me, whatever, but thanks for coming.